Wanishi, Keisha Lamuquin, Bake Serene Sally, Ubake 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 Serene Sally. I am the son of Tara, son of Michael, grandson of Barbara and Ronald, Sharon and Mary, great grandson of Lizzie, Grady, Ivy, Texan, Robert, Agnes, Hannah, Ernest. Honor your ancestors, and your days will be long. And this is medicine. 40 days and 40 nights on the North Pacific. Starts to read like a prophecy if you know the scriptures. For the sake of enlightenment, I embarked a mission. In the belly of the beast, under harsh conditions. Who else you know was a carpenter and a fisherman? Connected to the earth and made land sing like Michigan. Rain dancing to the beat of the Most High's drum. Standing on the shoulders of giants, no feet, 5 feet I'm from. A land where brothers stand by the hydrant. Fire, water, you don't wanna see the mice run. 3 sons in my orbit, lives bless me with daylight. So I'm investing my savings and showing their future stay bright. Black lives matter, hold up, only if you claim white. Looking at these protests like they ain't playing the game right. What's hidden in plain sight remains out of reach to the blind. They say Jupiter's the reason we climb, but we only reach ascension when we hit a decline. Instead of reaching with my hands out, I'ma reach in my mind. Take the chips out of the cortex and reach the divine. Transformation, I'm the living, breathing Optimus Prime. Fingerprints next to the dots on these lines. And watch the Kundalini rise through every single knot on your spine. If you not catching these seeds, then you are not on your grind. Twist the J up for the chief is getting out of their time zone. Fly, paper planes out in the sky. Trying to get this cancer out of July. While I'm alive, medicine wheel. Moving through the zodiac signs. 12 sides to a story, don't be skipping no lines. Me, I sip and I tie. All my symbols are sealed. When I was floating on the ocean, all these things were revealed. I came back to the land and then I saw how he kneeled. And everybody took the bait while they still making their deals. I'm just here to bring this medicine to wake up and heal. Willfully they'll stop misplacing their zeal. Willfully they'll stop making all these vacant appeals. And stop making a scene so we can make it for real. Copper penny skin magic, never play with Shaquille. Stop making the scene so we can make it for real. I yield, 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 yield. Bucket mom set a fuck, 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 bucket mom set a fuck. Waf Talana, Kula Babin, Kunta Fatin, Salihin, Aminal, Kerati Allahu.
Paul says in chapter 1, verse 18, that there is this thing called the suppression of truth. You can actually hold truth down against its will. Because the goal of truth is to be true. But when you don't want the truth, you force it down, you hold it down, you deny it, reject it, limit it, compromising it, because that's not what you want. So you suppress the truth.
Been seeing you for quite some time. I have never met somebody who has you're one of the most adamant brothers I've seen on the scenes when it comes to telling what we call black people that they are indigenous to this country. There's a lot of misconceptions flowing around. I see you, when I was on Facebook, I seen you post a lot. I know you have a bloodline that you share that you can actually prove. You have history that you can actually prove. Tell the people that are totally, I mean totally fucking confused by all the talk going on in the black community about you're African, no, you're Asian, no, you're the real Indians, no, you're this now. Fuck it, we came from everywhere. People like, I don't know what to think anymore. Turtle Gang, just tell the people, clear some confusion for them, because I know you're real adamant about that.
Nobody know that shit like you. Nobody know that like you.
They reject it. They deny it.
The The first migrations that came to the American continent were short-statured African people known as the Paleo-Americans, or who we call the Twa Mbuti. The second were who we call a taller stature African known as the Clovis Folsom. The third migration coming to this country were known as the Algonquin. The fourth are known as the Inuit, or who are derogatorily called the Eskimo. Eskimo is a derogatory term towards the indigenous people that we call the Inuit. The fifth migration came in large numbers, and they were escaping the Mongol invasions like Genghis Khan. And they came across. That's who we give credit for the Bering Strait. The first Africans that came to America came from Africa to America.
Yeah, Indians, niggas, same thing.
One of the things I've come to realize with our children and with our nation, with our people, is the need for us to understand who we are.
Who are you?
Where we've been.
Me? I know who I am.
But I'm very much into the science.
What the fuck are you guys talking about?
As a person of African descent with Native American ancestry,
what?
We have a great science background as a people. And when I hear folk talk about we're illiterate, you know, there's just a very serious problem with that.
What?
Because I happen to know for sure, beyond a shadow of a doubt, when you don't know who you are, when you don't know what you have done, when you don't know what you've achieved, anybody can tell you anything and you can fall for the opium. Let me ask you this. If somebody says that these documents say who you are, this is you, this is who you are, from a cosmic perspective, if you own yourself, you claim yourself, you are sovereign to yourself, do you need any documents created by them to claim your personality?
No.
So my answer is...
I know what dude I am.
Well, I was going to say something, but I'm not going to go there. It is to know yourself, you possess yourself. When you possess yourself in the sense of self-actualization, there is no law that you guide. Nobody tells you. You don't need it because you run yourself.
I know who I am.
Why are you going to go to an oppressor to ask for your freedom when if that oppressor was going to give you your freedom, why would they have oppressed you in the first place?
He's rational.
Yeah, Indians, niggas, same thing.
And Tap, brothers and sisters.
I
am really very happy to be here, to be able to share this kind of time with you. I'm an educator, and in fact, I'm coming from a class that I'm teaching right now, SUNY New Paltz, State University New Paltz, about 82 miles north. That's why I'm running just a little bit behind my schedule. But I'm teaching a course, college course, Introduction to Africa. And it deals with the African presence in early Asia. And one of the things that I've noticed, my background is with children. That's really where my area of teaching really is, to get to the children. I have my license is in early childhood. I'm a kindergarten teacher, but in my career, I've taught just about all the grades. And one of the things I've come to realize with our children and with our nation, with our people, is the need for us to understand who we are, where we've been. But I'm very much into the science. As a person of African descent with Native American ancestry, we have a great science background as a people. And when I hear folk talk about we're illiterate. You know, there's just a very serious problem with that. Because I happen to know for sure, beyond a shadow of a doubt, that we taught the world how to read and how to write. We taught them how to talk. And so it's very difficult for me to perceive a concept that we could ever be illiterate. And when we don't know, as the brother had said in the piece that we watched, when you don't know who you are, when you don't know what you have done, when you don't know what you've achieved, anybody can tell you anything and you can fall for the okey-doke. And what I have noticed over time is that times are changing. Times are changing very quickly. And I've noticed it because years ago, when I was first moving through this process, my teacher is Professor John Henry Clark. That is who I give all credit for much of who I am. And I was blessed by meeting this brother very young, when I was about 12 and a half. And this is probably why I decided to become a childhood teacher, because I wanted to reach our young people at a time before all the garbage is written on the chalkboards of their mind. I wanted to get them at a point in time where the instructions, the information that I was sharing, that was to bring them out. Because that's really what all this is. Educare means to bring out.
Yes, sir. Check.
And as I have related, when I walk into a classroom, when I walk into this room, I am not in any way thinking that I am giving you something that you did not have before you came into this room. The way in which I am facilitating what I'm saying to you is with an understanding that my job is to assist you in finding this information in the recordings of your mind. It's like if we turned off all the lights in this room, couldn't see anything. And you found in your own way the light switch and turned the light on. And when you turned the light on, you saw the chairs, you saw each other, you saw the film, you saw the screen, you saw the machine. The question is, did all these things appear in the room when you turned the light on? No, they were always there. Your light just wasn't on. Yeah. And that's how I see information. Yeah. See the brother agreeing with me. The light went on. Yeah. You see, I mean, the light goes on. But what I'm saying to you is that how could I ever say something to you that you don't already know? How could I do that? That's not possible for me to take something from out here and place it in you so that now you know something you didn't know prior to me saying it. That's not possible. The only thing I could ever possibly do is to assist as facilitator, as a teacher. Even in my kindergarten classes, I walked in considering the fact that every five-year-old knew everything that I was saying, but they were just realizing that they realized that they always knew it. That's a totally different way of imparting information than if I think I'm coming in here to impart pearls of wisdom to people who do not know. And that is the way our ancestors taught. Think of it this way. When I've studied, see, the thing about my relationship with the Moors is that I've moved into the study of what we call Moorish history through the Prophet Noble Drew Ali, studying him as an individual, who he was and what he did. And that's very important. And the advantage that I bring to the discussion, that's okay, brother, you don't have to go. You don't have to go, because I'd rather him be right here and listen to everything I say. He can talk, he can talk. We can concentrate over the brother's talking, so it's okay. And I can concentrate over talking also, so please, I'd like the brother. Remind me of my kindergarten class. I like that. And I've never gotten to see, because, you know, we always say we should bring our children. But when children start acting like children, we start wanting them to leave. And I'm saying to myself, children are going to be children. Don't be embarrassed. Don't be upset. Don't be shushing the child, because I can concentrate over their conversation. And I'm hoping that you can concentrate over their conversation as mature individuals. So I don't have no problem, because I'm used to being around children all the time. And it was interesting because in my classrooms in kindergarten, the children that were with me, they were loud. And they talked a lot. And I didn't mind that. I had no problem with that. And I often wonder how mean we are to attempt to make children act like adults. Like, as adults, we can sit and somewhat discipline ourselves not to talk. Okay, we can do that. But as a child, in your search for self, you're not supposed to do that. I'm worried about children that do, because those are the same children that will be used, abused, and taken advantage of by the system when they get older, because we've beaten them into submission. I am not saying there's not a level of respect. I understand that. That's something different than what I'm saying right now. But I had lively conversations, and as I, and I'm talking about, like, I've graduated from the Board of Ed. Some people call it retirement. I call it, after 31 years in 2009, I graduated. So I've been around long enough to have, in fact, I had a sister who was the grandmother of a child that I was teaching. And she was in middle school too, so. And I had mother in kindergarten. So, you know, you got to get out of the system when you start teaching people's grandchildren. 31 years. And I meet up with my children now that I had when they were little children. They're in their mid to late 30s, early 40s. And one of the things that they say, I think, that I really appreciate is that, like, I used to talk to them just like I'm talking to you. There was really no difference. You know, and there was a safe haven. Our children felt, you know, I was in the South Bronx. I taught District 9, South Bronx. Yankee Stadium was our southern boundary. Went up to about 183rd Street. Went from the Harlem River over to about maybe Fulton Street in the Bronx. So that whole big area there was where we had like 43 schools. And I felt that what our people need is a safe haven. There are certain things about us as a people, and I appreciate respect. And my area that I really focus on is ancient Africa. But probably one of the greatest classical civilizations of African people, you just have to go to the plantation. Some of the finest minds were on the plantation. Some of the finest astronomers were on the plantation. Some of the finest mathematicians, the geographers, were on the plantation. Harriet Tubman was one of the greatest astronomers that walked the earth. She was an agriculturalist because her daddy taught her how to read moss on rocks to know if you're traveling north. She tuned her ear to be able to hear things that other folk didn't hear. She trained her eye to see things that other people didn't see. And so in so many different ways, we come from a legacy. So we don't have to go back to ancient Egypt to celebrate our classical Africanness. We can go back a couple of hundred years. And this is another thing, because I do appreciate Egypt, Kemet. I do appreciate all that we have done in ancient history. But I marvel at what we did in this segment of history. And that's not to be lost in our understanding of who we are as a people. Because that plantation life was quite something else. And I'm always careful. I always quote my brother Kwame Ture, but I'm always careful talking about superiority, inferiority. I do believe what Dr. King says, that it's the content of your character that makes you who you are. And that because you're born into a particular cultural group, it doesn't mean that you're superior because of the nature of being born in that group. That's not what makes you royal. What makes you royal is how you conduct yourself on the planet. Royalty is not a position, it's a way of living. You're not born into royalty. They may say they're born into royalty, but with the way in which some of them conduct themselves, that's not royal. You can try to make it seem that way, but when you look at the way life is, that's not. But there are other people I know that walk the streets of 125th Street, may never have gotten out the seventh grade, may not have that much to live, and their house may not look like a palace, but they are walking kings and queens. But that's for us to decide, not for people to tell us. See, because Kujichagulia, self-determination, the concept of determining for yourself who you are, Wade Noble says that power is the ability to define someone else's reality and have that person accept that definition as if it were their own. Mm-hmm. As an African people, we have been living a life allowing other people to define who we are. Defining what we can do and what we cannot do, what our potential is, and how much it should be. We have allowed ourselves to look at, with honor and respect, President Barack Obama. And we're so happy. But President Obama comes in a long, there was a time when only black men and women ruled the world. But because we have so disconnected ourselves from consciousness of the past, we view him as a great and mighty, and he is great. But remember, there was long lines of pharaohs that sat on the thrones of ancient Kemet that ruled the world. They were the most powerful human beings on the planet. So President Obama is not like something that I'm not used to. You know what I'm saying? He's not the first. He may be first in this time in history, but he's really the rule and not the exception when you look at world history. There's a book by a brother by the name of Ian Smart. He wrote a book called From Narmer to President Obama. And I encourage you to get that book because, you know, even when you look at today's history, one of the most powerful nations on the earth today, very rich and very powerful, people don't try to play it up too much, is ruled by a black woman. Brazil. That's a sister who is the president of Brazil. And that's an up-and-coming power to be reckoned with. The largest community of African people outside of the continent herself is Brazil. For every 100 Africans stolen from Africa, 39 were brought to Brazil by the Portuguese. We're going to understand our history. We have to know who we are and what we've done. And those brothers and sisters broke out into the Palmeiras and the Quilombos, and they were free. And this is their history. This is our history here in this hemisphere. And these are the kinds of things that we have to start to look at and understand very clearly. And no pomp and circumstance, because I'm not using this to be better than anybody else. I'm only using this as a catapult to help our children become the people that Harriet Tubman believed them to be. Because she certainly did not do what she did for us to end up the way some people think we are ending up. I'm not accepting that. My thing is, it ain't over till we win. But we have to know who we are. We have to know what we've done. But we have to understand science. Let me give you something else you might want to look at. Because, see, I drop a lot of books on folk. Because we got to start reading. Okay, let's be real. We have to start. And if you don't, then you need to go someplace where you can learn how to read. I'm being very serious. We have to learn how to read. I'm not saying reading is the only means of learning, but there's a lot of information out here in the books. We have to start to become a reading people. We have to stop playing with our minds. And I realize that there are some of us who, because of the way in which this educational system has done it, it has failed. But they really haven't failed. In fact, they really succeeded, to tell you the truth. We failed to understand their game plan. Because their purpose was to miseducate our children. It always has been. It always will be. And this is something else. And we have to take the education of our community and our children into our own hands. I know how we got here. I know how we got here. I know how they ambushed us, as Bob Marley say, ambushed us in the night. I know that. I know what they did to us. I know how they told untruths. I know how they waited to get us in our lowest moment. I know they waited until we began to fight amongst each other, because, you know, that's another thing. As I've studied history from ancient Kemet straight to the Moors, because Bob Abdil was fighting his father-in-law when Granada was brought down by Castile and Aragon. We were fighting amongst ourselves in Spain. Nowhere in my study of our history have I ever seen any group outside of us bring us down on their own. We've always been fighting amongst ourselves. Ancient Kemet, the intermediate period, came about because we were fighting amongst ourselves. That's the truth in terms of what history tells us. Pharaoh Pepi the First and Pepi the Second got very rich. This is at the end of the classic age of the pyramid age. And please, brother.
I noticed you talk about a lot about the history, which is a great thing in the book that's reading. But why is this omitted from the books about the great kings that were actually doing a lot of the diplomats and a lot of the information that the women were doing was never transmitted, even spoke about?
That's right.
Why was that only?
Because we're living in a patriarchal society. And let me tell you something, then I'm gonna say something about the point that you're making. Patriarchy never existed amongst African people. Patriarchy was created within Europe in order, in fact, brother, that held up modern Britain's ancient and modern, there was a two-volume set, David McRitchie, okay? You know, that whole idea of Patrick, there was no such man as named St. Patrick. He didn't exist. Patrick is the male force that brought down the Celtic Druids, who were the ancient African priests and priestesses. Okay, and that's why Patrick is stepping on the snake, because the snake is the feminine principle that represents wisdom and knowledge in the third eye, the uraeus. So St. Patrick becomes the image of European male domination. In Africa, you did not have patriarchy. You had matrilineal. And matrilineal represented the lineage going through the female line, because it was through the womb that you were able to take your lineage and your place in society. So the women, it wasn't about archy, which is power. It was about the line of descent came through the female. Everybody talks about the male pharaoh that sat on the throne, but nobody talks about the queen mothers that chose the pharaoh.
Yes.
Nobody talks about the fact that, yeah, the male sat on the throne, but the throne was the feminine principle, Aset. She had it on her crown. Wherever you see the throne, you know. In other words, it is the queen that makes the king.
Right.
Black men, we never had a problem understanding this. We always understood and respected the feminine principle because, quite frankly, aren't we, each and every one of us, half man and half woman? And it just happened to be our daddy's chromosome, the Y chromosome, that decided that the Y would be male and his X would be the female. Simple like that. It was meant by nature for there to be more women than men on the planet. That's why there are three X's and one Y. Because it's important to always keep the human family growing. Women have two X, men have one X, one Y. It was meant for men to be outnumbered 3-1. Nature said that. And as black men, we never had a problem, because to celebrate Women's History Month is to celebrate half of ourselves. And we never had a problem understanding or confusing what we were talking about when we talked about being half man and half woman. Because we had a mother and we had a father. And when a mother goes to protect a child, that's not the mother in her. That's the father in her. That's the protective energy. When brother is holding his child, that's not the father in him. That's the mother in him. That's the nurturer in you. That's the feminine principle. And we understood male, female, balance. There were principles. There were characteristics that were female. There were characteristics that were male. And out of those, we knew when to pull what in. And because we have now been brought upon by a people who know not their mother, do not respect their women, we now have carried on this nonsense that they were doing in the caves. African people all, but they were just depigmented and they got a calcified pineal gland. And they lost their abilities to touch the realities of their spiritual base, which is the pineal gland, and it became calcified. Calcified pineal gland, if you want to look at it physically, is shaped like a little pine. It's located in your third ventricle. It's the reason why some people call it a third eye, eye of Heru. See, I'm carrying a couple of eyes, and one. Okay, insight. It is what Heru was given by Tehuti if he could solve a problem. Insight, not just outside, but insight. And the concept is that a healthy pineal gland looks like a grape. A calcified pineal gland looks like a raisin. A raisin is a grape that's had its life liquid sucked out of it. That's why it's called sun-dried. Okay. The feminine principle played a most important balancing role. In fact, she herself represented balance in the form of Ma'at. So the feminine principle was always there, was never denigrated, because to denigrate your female is to denigrate yourself. So the concept for African people really was never there. And when we get it, in fact, we shouldn't even call them Pharaoh. You know, our brother Mfudishi, you know, gives us the word Nesubiti. And our women, queen, shouldn't call them queen. Brother says, Hemet Nesut. Okay. Hemet Nesut. There's another word. There's a third word that comes after Nesut. Warret. Okay. That's what we call our queen, our female principal, that which balances us. That's what we call them. These are the kinds of things, you know, and when you look at the bee, think of the bee. Everything that our ancestors did in ancient Kemet always had a natural reason for it. Think of what they did when they took the bee. What does a bee do? A bee takes nectar, half and partially digests it, and then regurgitates it. And that's what honey is. Honey is partially digested and regurgitated nectar. And what does most religions say you will do when you die? You will feast on nectar. Okay? And that's why Biti was that God on earth that was living a life. What do we say? That you will always have what? Milk and honey. Okay? So you had the bee and you had Heteru. Think of our ancestors and how they did this very naturally, very scientifically. Nothing was out of order. Nothing was like it was just these crazy ideas that they would try to get you to believe about our ancestors in Egypt. Everything they did had a fundamental purpose, and all of it brought the very best out of the individual. Up in the heavens, as you look up into the heavens and you see melanin. See, we have to understand melanin. We have to know what melanin is. We have to know what melanin is on the cosmic or the in the heavens. We got to know what it is on the earth, and we have to know what it is organically. Melanin is in everything. There was a great Olympic runner, I believe it was Malachi Andrews from California, and he said that melanin was the mothership. It was the mothership of the universe, and all you have to do is just go to one of George Clinton's concerts to see that mothership come down, you know, the mothership connection, because that's what the brother was talking about. Because George Clinton was the first brother that even introduced me to the concept of the Dogon, and that's years ago. And when I was living in Washington, D.C. back in 1978, they had the Chocolate City concert. 19 hours from Bootsy Collins, George Clinton, Parliament Funkadelics in Robert F. Kennedy Stadium. Funkateria, the brother come out with the baby diaper on and everything. I said, wait, the brides of Funkenstein. Hey, you know what I'm talking about. This brother was dropping knowledge in his work, not to mention Earth, Wind, and Fire. I mean, they took the elements to disguise who they were. Serpentine fire. So this information is here. It's to be understood. But with our challenges and with the pain that we've been through, we should also celebrate. Because no matter what they did to us, despite and in spite of our experiences over the past couple of centuries, still we rise. That's to be celebrated. And in certain ways, for those that would wish to denigrate, put down, we have to move to another level and shift the paradigm of how we're looking at ourselves. Because quite frankly, I don't care if we're in prison. I don't care if we're selling our bodies on the corner. I don't care if we're pimping. I don't care if we're drug addict. For a black person to be alive in America 400 years after what happened to us, that's a miracle. Woo, break it down. The fact that we're still here is really a miracle. Because the great majority of peoples could never have survived what we've been through. And still we can meet like this. That says a lot about us as a people. If you stop and think about it. If you stop and think about it. Kwame Ture tells us, you know, about, again, I don't believe in superiority and inferiority, but brothers and sisters, I just have to beg the question for us to figure this out. If you have somebody that wants to achieve great things and they achieve great things and they achieve and they achieve and they achieve and they become very great, that's great. That's great. But if you have another person who wants to achieve great things And at every turn, something is put in their way to stop them from being able to achieve. Yet, despite and in spite of all those obstacles, still they become great. This is great, but this one is greater. Not because they're African American, but because of the hell they've been put through, and still they could rise. That is a powerful thought for each and every one of us to think about ourselves in what we do. Because no matter where you are in your life, to be what you are, you had to be better than the most people out there that never had anything put in their way. And this is our history. We now, in 2011, are becoming conscious of our ancestors in Kemet. We have our scholars from Dr. John Henry Clark to Yosef Ben Yekanin to John G. Jackson to Sharshi McIntyre, Dr. Edward Scobie.
Booker T. Coleman.
Hotep on that. I appreciate you. I'm working at it. I appreciate you. These scholars are all around us. Okay, and they're enlightening us to this experience that we've had as a people. But we have to take advantage of this, and we have to stop talking and start doing. I know how we got in this position. I know what has happened to us. But on a personal level, I take full responsibility for the position that I find myself in. I'm not blaming nobody for the position I'm in. I am responsible. And I'll tell you why. It's not because I don't know who put me there. It's because if you put the responsibility for your position in the hands of somebody outside of yourself, you give that person the power to keep you in that position. But once you assume full responsibility, you can do whatever you need by any means necessary to get yourself out. And when they get involved and want to talk, you mind your business. This ain't got nothing to do with you. This is on me. This is not on you. I'm not blaming you. And they actually get very offended. Well, what do you mean I don't have nothing to do with it? See, when you blame them, they're upset. When you don't blame them, they're scared. Because they understand the ramifications of a people who assume full responsibility for the position that they find themselves in. Again, it's not that I don't know how we got here. It's that we don't have time to blame. We can spend the rest of our lives talking about who threw us in the pit. I'd rather spend my time getting out the pit. And so we have to study our history. We have to understand, but we have to do it from a scientific perspective. We have to look at the Shabaka stone in ancient Kemet. We have to understand the pyramids. We have to understand science, math, technology. Let me send you to a website. Let me encourage you to buy the books. I don't know who the brother or sister is, but it's www.africancreationenergy.com. Those are some powerful books. And that said, see, let me start with them. Western civilization, who sat at the feet of the Africans, who we call the Moors, never really and truly understood the alchemic process. They never really understood what our ancestors, Africans, were telling them. So they got so caught up in messing with number 79 and number 80 on the periodic table of elements. Okay, 80 is one of two liquids that exists, and we use it to tell the temperature. What is it called? Mercury. If you take one proton and one neutron out of mercury, you step it back into 79, which is what? Gold. So our ancestors were able, in fact, Dr. Gabriel Ayibo, he teaches us, there's only one atom in the world. There's only one element. There's only one thing in the world upon which everything else is based on. And that is the universe. But in science, that one thing is what we call hydrogen. That's why it's number one on the periodic table of elements. And number two is helium, which is two hydrogen. Lithium is number three, which is three hydrogen. Carbon is six, which is six hydrogen. Eight is oxygen, which is eight hydrogen. So you could go all the way through, even going down to number 92. It's still 92 pieces of hydrogen. So out of this one explosion came all of these atoms or these elements that create all the different things that we have. The only difference between a chair and a human is the way in which the molecules are put together. Once that scientific principle is there, then you can manipulate. And when you manipulate, to them, it's Merlin. To Africans, it's life. See, they think that's magic. To Africans, they didn't know such thing as magic. Magic as a word didn't exist to Africans. The word that Africans use that we call magic, they call will. Heka. To will something to happen. You will it to happen. Harriet Tubman created magic by willing the freedom of herself and over 300 people. And so this becomes, okay, good, wonderful. And what's going to happen after that? Okay. And so out of these chemicals and these molecules, African Creation Energy, I encourage you to get these books. These are really good, particularly for our children, particularly for us, because then we'll understand. I wish I knew when I was young what I know now about these sciences and this man. It's wonderful. Physical science, we call it STEM. Science, technology, engineering, and math. STEM. The physical science is nothing more nor less than the concretization of the spiritual sciences, which is the performing arts, the creative arts, and the language arts. And the way in which we answer the who, the what's, the where, the how is the social sciences, which is geography, history, politics, economics, and culture. That's the liberal science, that's the arts and sciences right there. In our classrooms, in our colleges, all the things that we learn is right in what I just told you. See, they're afraid of using the word spiritual science. Seeing means to know. And Tehuti was, so science in the ancient world was all knowledge. It wasn't, this is why one of the attributes that we give to the creator is omniscient. Omniscient means all knowing. Seeing means to know. Out of that comes science. But in no way in the ancient world did it mean what it means now. When we think of science, we think of biology, astronomy, chemistry, things like that. In the ancient world, it's all knowledge. But see, the Western world had a problem with spirituality. So they didn't call it spirituality. In schools today, what do we call it? The communication arts. That's the spiritual sciences. The physical side, and that's the performing arts, creative arts, and the language arts. The physical sciences is the STEM. Check this out. We are taught by African Creation. Science is knowledge. And now here's where Clarence X, 13X, brother 5%, brilliant brother. You know, we have so many brilliant people that we've allowed people to confuse us. Because I remember growing up, a lot of people were afraid of the 5%ers, but never understood them. Never really understood what brother Clarence was talking about. You know, never really understanding the closeness between Brother Clarence X, Father Allah, and Malcolm X. Mm-hmm. They never knew they used to meet in coffee shops and talk to each other because they both were about to be expelled from the nation. Almost for the same reason. Okay. I mean, this is just very interesting information. But see, I like to look at things because I think as a people, we have to stop putting people on pedestals and worshiping them. Because the higher you put them on that pedestal, the higher the fall when you find out they were only humans all the while.
Yes.
We're going to look at all of these great people as human beings, capable of error, capable of making mistakes, taking their greatness and applying it in our lives and leaving what was not that great to the side and just put that in a big basket we call being human. Simple like that. At least to me, that is the way it is. Because when I look at Noble Drew Ali, I see a great man. I see a man that did great things. I see a man that fundamentally changed the very thought process of America. Because it was he who the Honorable Elijah Muhammad sat at his feet that would later become the Nation of Islam. Now, I know a lot of folk don't want to hear that. But we have seen the Honorable Elijah Muhammad with his red fez. We've seen him with that. We know clearly that the man that is said to be Fard Muhammad was part of the Moorish Science Temple. We know this by history. And that both of these men were together under the leadership of the Most Honorable Noble Drew Ali. This is history. This is not revelation. This is history. This ain't spirituality. This is history. Just like we in this room here together, this is history. This is no revelation. Okay? This is his plain up history. And that's why I try to stay historical, because when we start getting into revelation and religion, we start adding stuff that don't exist, and then we get caught up in the okey-doke, because the greatest religionists are the greatest superstitionists. Because the other side of having great faith is having great superstition. When you think if you don't say a prayer a certain way, it's not going to be answered. When you think that if you don't do it a certain way, it's not going to be. Because your heart is going to be measured. Maha teaches us this. Your heart is what's measured at the end. It doesn't make a difference how you celebrate the Mass. Makes no difference how you pray to your Creator. It's what's in your heart that your Creator, but not only that, not only does your Creator know, but you know, because each and every one of us, male and female, is God having a human experience. See, because I don't pray to nothing out there, because I don't know where that is. And I don't pray in here, because I don't know what that is. When I want to look at the face of God, I go into my bathroom, and I look in the mirror, and I'm looking at God. And when I look out here at y'all, I'm looking at God. And how I treat y'all is how I treat God. And if I take the time to be with you, to talk with you, if you take the time to be with me, talk with me, and if we have this, what we might call a experience, that's God's on earth. So Clarence 13 wasn't far from the realities of God's on earth. The Nuwabians are not far. Christians are not far. Jews ain't far. Muslims, Zoroastrian, Buddhism, because all of those religions are children of African spirituality. And if we can get to that understanding, we can walk out of this room here today different from when we walked in. But if this just becomes another experience out of the hundreds that we've had, and we go out there and we do the same thing we've been doing, what's the purpose? Brother Sabir?
Let's get brother.
Indians, niggas, same thing.
Our history is important when we tell it, you know?
I knew that something was wrong with all of that mess that came out of Hollywood. And so I'm asking the brother, but are you sure what I'm raising the issue of the negative stereotyping?
We've been here for at least the last 200,000 years, if not longer.
What the fuck are you guys talking about?
We got Native American background, the Powhatan Indian background, so I became the Powhatan Indian.
And everybody in the world is admitting this now. This is not new news. It's only being exposed more now.
He's right, you know.
So this is the Virginia mother. She was the Powhatan Indian. She said, we need to, when I was working with Alex Haley for 5 years, she said, you need to do our history. I said, Ma, I don't have time. I'm working with Alex. I'm working with Alex. I'm working with Alex.
In 1976, author Alex Haley wrote a novel that made history. He'd gone to Africa to trace his lineage, unthinkable at the time, and uncovered the story of Kunta Kinte. Haley believed he was descended from a young man who had been enslaved and brought to America in the 1700s. Following the Kinte family for six generations and many decades, Haley's book, Roots, was a revelation.
I knew that something was wrong with all of that mess that came out of Hollywood. When I was working with Alex Haley for 5 years, she said, you need to do our history. I said, Ma, I don't have time. I'm working with Alex.
Our history is important when we tell it.
He's right, you know.
Yeah, Indians, niggas, same thing.
Now, my next question was this. A lot of times we have, I guess, disagreements or different perspectives about the transatlantic slave trade. I wanted to know, what was your perspective on that? Like, do you feel like, are the numbers correct? Could it, I was watching the old video, for instance, and it was Dr. Clark on there. He was like, it was tens of millions. And Dr. Ben backed him up. He said it was tens of millions. But you have some people that feel like that didn't happen at all. And they discount it. So I just wanted to know, what was your perspective on Africans being taken from Africa and brought to America as slaves?
My concept is they're all right. They are all correct. They were the first human beings to come to the American continent were the Twa and Mbuti. There were five that we have counted so far, scientifically, migrations to the American continent, North, South, Central, and the Caribbean. And the first three were clearly, pigment-wise, culture-wise, African. The next two basically were somewhat Asian, if we want to call it that. You had the Paleo-American, or the Twa and Mbuti, you had the Clovis Folsom, and you had the Algonquin, all African. Varying forms, different times they came in waves. Thousands of years separated these migrations. The next one was the Inuit, or who we call the Eskimo. Mm-hmm. And the final one was the Asian, who was invading the Mongol invasions of Asia. And they came down into Canada, Alaska, and North America. So that when you're looking at the different migrations, there are some of us that I am sure have the original Paleo-American blood in us, but also those who were stolen from Africa post-1492 are also here. So we have to understand the waves of Africans. So everybody's right. And I'm watching them argue over each other, and I'm saying, but you're all right. Yes, right. It is African blood that is the original human being, the Twa and Mbuti, that we have inherited, not just from the Africans that were here, but from Native Americans who inherited the African legacy when they came here. Cherokee, Choctaw, Arapaho, Apache, okay? They have black blood in them. But don't forget, there were black people here that don't look like the people that claim to be Native Americans. They look more like you and I.
Right.
Okay. But the wave of Africans that came post-1492 also happened. And Africans were enslaved. There is a history of that. And I think we're getting it twisted and we're losing our African minds when we are historically off point by trying to make it seem like that enslavement didn't exist. It existed. It's just the way it is. That's history. But that's not to take away from the other waves of Africans that came. There were waves of Africans during the 1300s that left West Africa and came to America. But, you know, the point to pick up from where we left off, brother, we have got to be very clear, even to the point that you speak about, what do we call ourselves? What are we? Are we this? Are we that? The same is true is what happened to us as a people. I mean, did we come in the original years? I mean, there's evidence of Africans here that go back 100,000 years. There's evidence of a black woman in San Diego, California. Her bones dated 90 to 80,000 years ago.
Man.
So, you know, we have to understand that We all have to sit down and share information. And instead of arguing over arguing with each other over who's right and who's wrong, let's put our information on the table and as a group come to a consensus of at least the science of what's going on and stop fighting amongst ourselves, particularly when some of us exhibit deep ignorance in terms of where we're coming from and why we're saying what it is that we're saying, because our children are watching us. And we must conduct ourselves in a way that they respect us. But we must act respectfully to get respect from them. And I believe we have to have open conversations and respect and love each other enough to let everybody's information go out there and don't put somebody down because they may not think like you.
Definitely.
You know what I'm saying? So that I think that in answer to both of your questions, what I'm trying to do is show the roundabout way that we can begin to look at ourselves and to be able to respond to ourselves in ways that it makes sense.
Oh yeah, most definitely. Yeah, that kind of goes into my next question. I wanted to talk a little bit about the African presence in Asia. We had spoke a little bit about that, about the Africans that went into the Philippines, and they were calling them Negritos, or the, I forget what the other name was.
Yeah, I knew.
I knew, right.
A-I-N-U is one of the names, particularly in Japan. But again, these are Twa and Mbuti people, short stature, maybe 3 feet 8. Same exact people. They peopled the planet. There was a time that the only people on the planet were the Twa and Mbuti people. There was nobody else on the planet but them. Wasn't no Europeans. There were no Asians. There was just a short-statured Twa and Mbuti that came out of one of the final phases of the ascendancy of who we call Homo sapiens sapiens, the sixth level of the human form. And out of the end came this family, Twa and Mbuti Khoisan. And these individuals coming out of that began to intellectualize and began to think on higher levels about 120,000 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And by about 100,000 years, they were all over the planet. Within 20,000 years, they had peopled the planet. And that's who you see from continent to continent.
Right. And these people are still there. I've been to the Philippines. I lived in South Africa. They still dark skin, brown skin, curly hair.
You've seen them?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. You're saying that you've seen them, right?
Yes.
That's who they are. That's the original people. They still amongst us. And there are African Americans that look like them.
Yeah.
I knew a brother was a martial artist. This brother was bad, but he was all of about 4'2". Perfectly proportioned, but this brother was good in martial arts. But he is who we would consider to be an African American.
Wow.
He has the blood. I think Sammy Davis Jr. was Twa and Mbuti. When you look at a short statured person, many times they have the blood of the Twa and Mbuti. That's just genetics, brother. Fruits, vegetables, farms. They don't show you that. They don't show you the success. You'll grow up, as Muhammad Ali always talks about, looking at Tarzan. But how you go to the beach, it's hot in Africa, particularly during the day. So they depict Africans running around with no particular direction. Now, mind you, this is the movie. This is not what's actually happening. But they will have Africans running around aimlessly, not understanding what they're doing. That's not who Africans are. And when night falls and it gets cool, African put the kente cloth on. But they don't show you that. They just show it to you like they're running around in loincloths with no direction. But when it gets cool at night, they put the gold on. They put the kente on. They put the garments on. They put the boobas on. but won't show you that. And so there are so many people that don't want to identify with Africa because they don't know Africa. And this is also at the root problem of indigenous American people who would look what I'm considering to be the more Asian. I'm not talking about the $5 ones. I'm not even talking to them. They don't count in this conversation. Wow. They want to steal you, family. They want to steal everything about you. That's what George G.M. James wrote about in Stolen Legacy. They love to hate you, and they hate to love you. They can't help themselves. These are mentally disturbed people, family. Look at them. Look at what they did to justice. Look at what they did to my aunt. Just look at the court cases. Justice. Richard Pryor say, yeah, it's justice. Just us. Because they know if we get ourselves together, if we get ourselves together, it's over. But I have a message for them. We're getting ourselves together as we speak. For those of you here who are spending this time together with me and I with you, as we speak, we're getting this together. And Bob Marley tells us, have no fear for atomic energy, for none of them can stop the time. And I interpreted what Bob Marley meant when he said that atomic energy representing Western civilization. Have no fear for white supremacy. None of them can stop the time. And by the way, have no fear for China. They're in trouble too. Have no fear for Russia. They're in trouble too. And what's interesting is all those three governments are exactly the same. They're socialist governments. They're not socialist for the social society of the people, but they're social for rich people in China and in Russia and in the United States and in parts of Europe and parts of Africa. Come on, let's go get real. Gotta drop it, because we got to improve and correct the error. And if we don't identify something because we don't emotionally want to get involved, then we'll have a challenge. It's happening, the material world. But the point that I'm making is this: have no fear for atomic energy. None of them can stop the time, family. Nature is not cruel, but nature's not going to make it easy. Nature wants you to earn your greatness. They just don't want to give it to you. But solar power is the future wealth of the planet. And isn't it interesting that everywhere that the sun shines the brightest, the people are the most melanated, inside and out? Because it's not just about your physical complexion. That's your skin. That's true. But dwelling within you is melanin all throughout your body. In fact, if you didn't have it in your eyes, you couldn't see it. If you didn't have it in your ears, you couldn't hear. If you didn't have it in your heart, it wouldn't beat. If it didn't, you didn't have it in the blood, it wouldn't circulate. And if you didn't have it in your lungs, you wouldn't be able to breathe. Melanin is the mothership, the cosmic universe. And it's funny how everybody's running away from her. They're disclaiming her. No, I was the first here. No, you were not the first here. The Twa and Mbuti were the first here. And I know that the way in which they're depicted is very derogatory. And they are called derogatorily, they're called pygmies, because they used to be called my little pigs. Because they were short statured. And the Europeans had no respect for them. So they called them my little pigs. And they said, well, no, you can't really do that. So they said, okay, we'll change it around. We'll take the end and bring it to the front. And instead of my little pigs, we'll call them pygmies. No decency, integrity, honor amongst thieves, liars, and cheats. And family, we have to make a decision. My thing is education. That's why I do these webinars, the Quibinars on Tuesday. to bring you information. I assure you, I will never waste your time. The information I'm giving to you is verified and has been satisfied. I would not say something to have you go out and repeat what I said and you not able to back up what you say, particularly in science. It's not all the time. I don't say that because it's in a book. It's true. What I'm telling you is that when you take the books that I give to you as my research is done and you trace it back, there's a common sense approach where you can take the sense out the nonsense. You can take the best and leave the rest and come to a cogent, intelligent conclusion on your own. But let me allow you, if anything, don't believe me. Just allow me to have you think about what I'm saying. Everywhere around the world, the original family was related. The Negritos of the Philippines, the Champa people of Vietnam, the Ainu people of Japan, the Twa Mbuti of Central and South Africa, and the Paleo-Americans, the first Americans, they were all related to each other. They just happened to leave the planet, cross across it, go across the earth, and inhabit it. But they're all related. And out of those base family people came all of us. And if you backtrack your family lineage back to the origins, the autochthonous people, the people that came from the soil. There is only one place on the planet where the people came from the soil. Everybody else immigrated. Everybody is an immigrant. The only ones that's not an immigrant is the Twa, Mbuti, Moesha, Khoi, San of Central and South Africa. That is where life began. It was conceived, it was born, it was nurtured, sustained, it was breastfed, educated, and civilized in Africa. And after these Twa Mbuti got their show together, then they took it on the road and peopled the planet. And that's the Thanksgiving that I'm looking forward to on Olmec Day. And I know that it's rough that you're saying, well, this is not a holiday for us. Well, no, yes, it is. In our own way, not their way. First of all, that's not even the true story. But I'll leave that alone for now. But I just wanted to come on. Two things I wanted to do with you this evening, family. Well, three things. First of all, say Hotep, peace, salam alaikum. The second thing I wanted to do was to let you know that you should have no fear for atomic energy. Our ancestors have been through much worse than what we're going through now. And I can only imagine what they had to go through. And yet they stuck it through. That's why we're here. And I ain't never going to give up. And everything that I do, I don't do for my ancestors. I do through my ancestors. For our children yet to be born. When they look back on us, and if they should do libation and call our names, what are they going to say we did? Did we just go along with the okie doke? Did we join the club and turn on our people? Or did we fight the good fight? I pray that they look back on us with grace, just as we look back on our Harriet Tubmans and our Frederick Douglasses and all of our ancestors that we may never know their name, but they put one foot in front of the other every day of their life, knowing that if they just kept on keeping on, somebody would be free sometime. And here we are. When they had that thought hundreds of years ago on the plantations, they manifested us. They brought us into existence. And I'm asking us to manifest, just as they manifested us, manifest our children of 2121. Whatever it is that you do, however you do it, wherever you are in your station of life, give back to the community. Don't pay back, pay forward. this is what we are trying to do in our quibinars and our webinars and our books on Amazon. That is what the scholars are doing. That is what the entertainers are doing. That is what the sports people are doing. My question is, what are you doing? Remember our ancestors and what they did. When I think, wow, I am just so impressed with their spirit. And I'm so appreciative to them for what they did for us. We have to do the same. And we have to show our children, the brothers on the corner, we got to talk to them. Don't have to have a long conversation with them. Just acknowledge them. Respect them. Ra means to look in a divine light. Ra, the sun, light, heat, energy. Ra, spec means to look. Look at them with respect. Look at them from a spiritual light. Look at them as our son or our daughter or our grandchild. Look at them again. But this time, look at them in a spiritual light. And just say, hey, how you doing? Don't have to have a conversation. Don't have to get deep. I've built relationships simply by starting by saying hello. And from there, it builds. Because when someone feels safe in your presence, they open up. And when they open up, because you're trustworthy, they will create a dynamic Black relationship. That is Black power. And that's why they're trying to divide us. Because they know that when we get down with our young people, we talk to them and they talk to us. They are excited to be with us and we are excited to be with them. That's power, family. That builds pyramids. That builds dynasties. Dynasties and nations. Nations are built by people. Dynasties are built by families. So family, have a phenomenal day. Check out the webinar that we put out on Friday, Ancient America. The theme is the Olmec heads because it's a theme. And this Thursday, while you understand the misgiving, also understand the Thanksgiving and give thanks to the Creator and our ancestors for all they did to make it possible for us to make it possible. Hotep family, thank you so much for your time. I appreciate your time. I respect your time. It's the most precious thing that you have and that I have. Keep on keeping on. It ain't over till we win. Solar power is the future wealth of the planet. Teach the children about Ra. Hotep.
We like to dance. We like to eat. And considering what I see in Africa, we got a thing for gold and diamonds. So nothing wrong with having good stuff. The question becomes, are you possessing stuff at the expense that other people go to bed without eating or having clothes on their back? That's the question. Nothing wrong with having wealth, but you got to know what to do with it. So your accumulation of wealth, it's almost like the spirit gives you this wealth for you to be able to do something with it for other people, knowing that you are so godly that you know what to do with it. So instead of getting a second car, you may find water for a very thirsty group of people. You may take the money that you would have purchased that other house, because you can only live in one house at a time. Okay, so instead of buying a second house, maybe you take that money and you develop a complex for a group of people to be able to live. Okay, that is why we are given wealth. But unfortunately, sometimes we are given things that we can't handle. And that selfishness creates the relationships that we are now on the planet experiencing. And so the whole purpose behind these mounds that our ancestors developed and created was to be able to understand that there is a life that goes beyond it. These mounds were meant to physically demonstrate these constellations. The same way we talked about the Muratunga, these mounds throughout the world And by the way, all these mounds face the same exact way. If you were to go above, so let me, now here's the other thing that I want to speak about. The ancient Africans knew exactly where they wanted to go. We know they understood cardinal points. We know that they had latitude and longitude lines because the Grand Gallery of Khufu's pyramid is built on the 30th parallel longitude east, 30th parallel north. The Grand Gallery is the meridian line. And it's 30 north, 30 east. So if they were so exact in developing that Grand Gallery, which is in the middle of the pyramid, they understood and knew how the earth was divided as it relates to the latitude and longitude lines that we have today. They built their systems around 360 degrees, so we know that they understood the circle. And so all of these pyramids in relationship to the world, when our ancestors set off to build them, whether it was here in the United States or whether it was in China, you know, there are pyramids in China.
Yes.
There's pyramids and mounds throughout the world. And you see, you don't have to build the perfect pyramids of Egypt for them to be lines of sight. Because look at the Muratunga was nothing but stones that were sticking up out the ground. Yet they were lines of sight. You can go to a place called Mount Taplaya. There's a gentleman who wrote a book, Black Genesis. Okay. Robert Bovall. He also worked with Thomas Brophy. But Thomas Brophy wrote a book called The Origin Map, which talks about the great year, the 26,000 year, okay? And in this book, they trace back and come to grips with it. These are two individuals that came to grips with the fact that yes, Africa civilized the world. And that for thousands of years, they dropped the knowledge and the wisdom that would build all of the technology that we today still use, and in many ways, we are not doing it as good as they did. The fact that that building fell down in Brooklyn, what was it, yesterday?
Yes.
Tells you that they're doing something wrong in their engineering. Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah.
Because you can't build a building everywhere.
Mm-hmm. Energy vortexes.
All over the planet, and our ancestors understood this. And by matter of degree, some were sacred, some were secular. But they understood the difference. You don't get secular when it's sacred. You don't get sacred when it's secular. They understood this. Our ancestors understood this. Some people might want to get into the religion of it. I don't get into the religion of it because religions are the children of spirituality. There's only one spiritual concept. There's only one. That's why it's called universe. One word. There's only one word. Bob Marley says it. Won't you help the saint? This redemption song, the resurrection song, the Osarian song. See, Bob Marley, this is his last song on his last album. The brother is dropping some knowledge. Emancipate yourselves from mental slavery. None but ourselves can free our mind. Have no fear for atomic energy because none of them can stop the time. See, I think that we give peoples of European descent too much credit. They're not that intelligent.
They brainwashed us.
Yes, I mean, the only power they have is the power over our mind. Mm-hmm. The only thing keeping them in power is us.
Fair.
Yes. If you believe in evolution, it's like a big bad wolf.
Yeah.
And if you believe in a big bad wolf, it doesn't care what type of house that you live in, you're going to be vulnerable for him to dominate.
Fair.
I look at them as children.
Dangerous children.
Yes. I talked to the master children.
Yeah. And sometimes they're not ready for a lot of the things that we would like to say. And then there are times that we need not speak. Because there are those that know the truth or think they know the truth or have a sense of the truth. But when they hear us, then they know not only the truth, but they know that we know it, and that becomes very dangerous. That's in the matrix. Yeah. Sister Sophia Stewart.
Look at you and know that you know.
Yes.
Say,
they can look at you and know that you know.
Yeah.
And you can look at this one and say, he's dead. That one?
Yeah. In the matrix, remember in the scene where there's a group that knows, and then in the middle there's a whole group of people that are just existing, and then there's the ones that know that they don't know, but know that you know. That's what Sophia Stewart was talking about. By the way, as you probably already know, Sophia Stewart's name of that, her book was called The Third Eye. And so that and The Terminator, which is also very interesting. But when you look at ancient America, in 1984, Dr. Van Sertima brought 40 people to Mexico, and I was one of them. And we studied the African presence in America, 1984, July of 1984.
Yes, same month my father, yes.
Is that right? Okay, 1984. Because it was a year after I went to Egypt, to Kemet. I went the first time with Dr. Ben in 83. And it was a blessing because Kemet was very fresh still in my mind when I went to Mexico in 84. And Dr. Van Sertima would have a lecture at night and we would visit. And Dr. Van Sertima did for us in Mexico what Dr. Ben did for us in Egypt. He cut short a lot of the errors that he made thinking something was there. So he took us directly where we needed to go. We saw not one Stonehead, not two Stoneheads. We saw eight Stoneheads. And there was one Stonehead that people were kidding me about because it has a space in its teeth. Said that everywhere. And so those are the Stoneheads we saw. So when people say they had very dull tools and that's why the nose was broad and the lips were big, well, it took, what kind of tool would put a space in between the two? And make the face smile, because you couldn't see the face if it didn't smile. He took us to Teotihuacan, right outside Ciudad de Mexico City, right? Ciudad de Mexico, Mexico City, right outside Teotihuacan. Pyramid of the Sun, Pyramid of the Moon. He took us to Palenque, to the Temple of the Inscription, where there is evidence of a Tomohuancan, which was their pharaoh. Tomohuancan buried in this sarcophagus.
Yeah, Indians, niggas, same thing.
Who are you?
Me? I know who I am. I'm a dude playing a dude disguised as another dude.
What? All ethnic groups in this country understand they got a nationality.
You dudes don't know what duty is.
We are a nation within a nation in this country searching for a nationality.
Or are you a dude who has no idea what duty is and claims to know what duty is?
What the fuck are you guys talking about?
Negro is not a nationality. Negro is not a nationality. Negro is not a nationality. And once we find our nationality and serve that nationality, we'll do for ourselves what needs to be done.
You're scared.
I ain't scared. Scared of what?
All ethnic groups in this country understand they got a nationality.
What's going on?
Because you answer to such stupid words like Negro and Cubs. In black, you have no nationality. Negro is not a nationality. Negro is not a nationality. Negro is not a nationality.
He's right, you know.
Some lazy Portuguese or Spaniard took an adjective and made a noun out of it. Colored is not a nationality. Colored is not a nationality. Colored is not a nationality.
He's right, you know.
Black tells you how you look, but it don't tell you who you are. Black tells you how you look, but it don't tell you who you are. Black tells you how you look, but it don't tell you who you are.
Sergeant Lincoln, Luther.
Right.
The name of a people must relate them instantaneously to land, history, and culture. And anytime you call a people by their right name, anytime you call a people, name a people, and fail to relate them back to land, history, and culture, you have called them out of their name. There's no black land or black hole. There's nothing wrong with the word black. Nothing wrong with it at all. only relate to a country. The name of every people in the world relate to country. And once you think instantaneously of land, you think of nationality. You belong to something big in the world.
I know who I am!
Yeah, Indians, niggas, same thing.
Now, what exactly is the summer solstice? Well, Earth is tilted at 23.5 degrees, and as it revolves around the sun, direct rays of sunlight hit different parts of Earth during different times of the year. And during the summer solstice, the direct rays of sunlight are over the Tropic of Cancer. It signals the start of summer in the Northern Hemisphere.
I'm a natural born citizen. Fuck the middleman. Boost of adrenaline. My children stomping on their forefathers. Get war mothers, great grandmothers, fucking land robbers. We got leases that tie up the pieces, fought off the leeches, blood sucking breaches. Push the poison from the pulpit to the government. I'm on some other shit. Crossbow with the rubber, eagle feather on my hip. My mama is the mothership. Sage burning, wave running on the Jersey Shore. Respect my ancestors, that's what I'm here for. Give your ass an earful. My ancestors got the answers. I'm a warrior, a rain dancer. I was born in Cancer. Summer solstice, photosynthesis, grandma. Summer solstice, photosynthesis, grandma. My ancestors got the answers. I'm a warrior, a rain dancer. I was born in Cancer. Summer solstice, photosynthesis, grandma. Summer solstice, photosynthesis, grandma. Make it rain. I ain't talking about change. I'm talking change. It's a new day. The same sun ray help the crops grow. From Jersey to the Alamo, reload the ammo. Lenape and camo. War cries like Rambo. Dropping bombs on your Lambo. We want our land, yo. Blood on our hands, yo. It's what we plan for. See the turtle rise. White doves in the sky. COVID got us mashed up. Look me in my eyes. Crook your hands. Handshake, see the snakes in disguise. Bullshit, draw flies. Guerrilla warfare, the element of surprise. Expose the devil lies. Tonight the earth cries. Tomorrow our flag flies. Wave it up high, put it way up in the sky.
One of our goals, is to become more vocal, conform other than not being the territory. It's still his.
None of this has anything to do with before 1492. This has everything to do with, ladies and gentlemen, let me show y'all again. He shows you the date right here. 1861 to 1497. Are you slow or are you stupid? This is what I mean. This is a clear case of being a plan on, my intelligence. Why am I so passionate about this? Because the research question is, was black people in America before 1492? And this mofo brings up Walter Ashby Plecker, who was born in 1861 and died in 1947. How the fuck can Walter Ashby Plecker have relevance and credence in answering if black people were in America before 1492?
I'll show you
how, Sway.
They talking this Walter and shit.
He I'll ain't show even you, helping Sway. Answer the research question.
I will show you, Sway.
You're insinuating something that ain't got shit to do with the debate topic.
Shit.
And y'all sit over there and talk that whole methodology shit and talk science and say you got this and got that. Oh, I got the clips where you booted me off the channel because I asked you a scientific question.
Logic to it, but it don't work, man.
And y'all buy this bullshit.
Yeah, I don't know
what's wrong with y'all. I know what's wrong with y'all. That's why I be saying what I be saying. See, y'all get high, smoke the good weed, and y'all can tolerate this bullshit.
Yeah, I do be getting high.
There's no way that I can, in my right mind, can I fathom to listen to a motherfucker pull up a source of a person that was born in 1847, in 1861, dies in 1947, and that's even trying to
get that shit all wrong. Fuck it,
what the hell, what relevance? Right, you got to go back to the Columbus letters, right? And any other chronicler or adventurer prior to Christopher Columbus, because that's your aim. Your aim is to predate Christopher Columbus, so you would need a chronicler and someone sailing prior to him that can answer your research question.
No,
instead, you got us up here listening to some pseudoscience.
Because eugenics
is a pseudoscience.
That probably established they're directly related to those people.
Well, I'm sorry, I apologize.
Because now they're going to have
the NOI. But affiliated with black people, the NOI. But come on, man.
They're going to have to say people. It's going to be a nigga 6'8" saying he twat.
Who's over this, right? That's so say eugenics and white supremacy. During the 1920s, Walter Plecker became an advocate of the pseudoscientific claims of eugenics. The word coined in 1883 by Francis Galton, your boy, right? And who else? Charles Darwin. Yep.
Pause. Once again, the research question is, was black people here again? The debate topic is, was black people in America before 1492? What the fuck does Darwin and Plecker have to do and Francis Galton? Let me clear some up. What the fuck does Francis Galton and Walter Plecker got to do with answering the research question?
It has everything
because
with
you bring Charles Darwin's name up, but Charles Darwin is not even associated with eugenics and the whole white supremacy bullshit. Because here's what it says in this statement. During the 1920s, Plecker became an advocate of the pseudo. It tells you. During the 1920s, Walter Plecker became an advocate of the pseudoscientific claims of eugenics. Who became an advocate of the pseudoscientific claims of eugenics, ladies and gentlemen? This is where reading comprehension comes in. He didn't even read this shit before debating, not a coincidence. He wasn't reading this shit.
Hey, he read any of that shit.
He wouldn't have put this shit on the screen.
Or something.
He put a pseudoscientific advocate on the screen. Has nothing to do with answering the research question of 1492 of if black people was here in the Americas. I keep saying that because it's the fact that they have poor research methodology. They don't have reading comprehension. But here's the funny part. The word coined in 1883 by Francis Galton. So in 1883, Francis Galton, who was the cousin of Charles Darwin, coined the phrase. So how the fuck does Charles Darwin get into this shit if his cousin coins a phrase, a name? But listen to what this dumb mofo says.
Pseudoscientific claims of eugenics. The word coined in 1883 by Francis Galton, your boy, right? And who else? Charles Darwin, your other boy, right?
Look, so ladies and gentlemen, I'm gonna play it one more time. Not a coincidence. I didn't see how you didn't clip this shit up, bro. I know you listening. I know you listening. You got your baby in your arms. I know you listening. I know you're not in the car getting high right now, nigga. Now ain't the time to get high. Listen. Put the weed down, Sutek.
Put the weed Lucky. Down.
Not a coincidence. Julanda, put the weed down. Put your blunt down, put your joint down, put down the bong. Put the edible down.
Put the bong Listen. Down. I'm gonna show you something.
He just made Charles Darwin a candidate of eugenics. Listen to him again.
Mm-mm-mm. What would he be doing hanging out with these? This was something that I found very interesting, right? This little article right here. I don't think nobody ever goes over this, right? So it said eugenics and white supremacy. During the 1920s, Walter Plecker became an advocate of the pseudoscientific claims of eugenics. The word coined in 1883 by Francis Galton, your boy, right? And who else? Charles Darwin.
That shit don't say in Charles Darwin. That shit don't say Francis Galton and Charles Darwin. He missed the whole cousin word. He missed. I don't even give a fuck if he called him a white supremacist. I don't give a fuck.
So
he missed the whole word, yo. Y'all talk about reading comprehension.
Reading comprehension.
It clearly says the word coined in 1883 by Francis Galton.
Hold up. Before we get too far, I'm gonna show you what they was actually trying to do when they all bring up this Walter Plecker. They're trying to use Walter Plecker Walter Plecker was, let's say, what he was doing. He was doing surgery. Walter Plecker was trying to extract specific groups. He was targeting specific groups. He wasn't just using a sledgehammer and trying to crush everything, right? Who was he targeting? He was targeting certain families that were of mixed heritage, right? That's who he was targeting. He wasn't targeting full-blood Indians. He wasn't targeting full-blood Negroes. He was targeting people who were mixed, all right? So everybody who jumps on the Walter Plecker thing, like they were reclassifying every Negro. No, they were reclassifying Indian families that looked like Negroes. The reason why these Indian families looked like Negroes is because they were mixed. They were intermarried. It was all about marriage. Got to go through the whole thing. And you'll find that there was a group of people that he really had his eye on. He even wrote handwritten notes about these people. This is what nobody's connecting. This is why this argument, bringing Walter Plecker into the conversation, only works if you're directly connected to the situation. So I'll give you an example of what that would be. All right, because this all ties into like history. So let me show you something. And this is what's going over all their heads. So
I'm gonna show you how this goes, right? So I got a brother up here coming at me for some reason. I guess Webster's dictionary, that shit bothered him. So now he wanna get at me, right? But this is how uninformed these people are. And this is how they appropriate other families' history. Check this out. He went to the Walter Plecker playbook. That's his move. That's his go-to move. All right, now this is the thing about Walter Plecker. We know what he's responsible for, right? We know the year. We know the general area, right? That's all people know. And they use that, right? Whether it was directly affecting their family or not, they use that. So he's talking about this anyway. When they gonna recognize Walter Plecker? Then he's asking me, he's trying to create some conspiracy about why I still know who I am and why my people never lost our traditions and things like that. He want to create a conspiracy, right? But he's talking about Walter Plecker. But I'm going to show you he hasn't done no research on Walter Plecker. Because if he really did the research on Walter Plecker, he would know that Walter Plecker targeted certain families, right? And then he would see the names of the families. And he would see Branham as one of the families. And then if he was any type of researcher, he would go look and see what my name is. Right? And he would see Branham. See, it's families that know their history because we kept our history. And your family probably kept your history too. You just denying it because you want to be something that you're not. Simple as that. Go look up Walter Plecker and see what family he was targeting. And then go on my social media page and look at my last name. And then look deeper and look at my first name, and you'll find that name on those lists too. This is how I know y'all don't be doing research. Because if any of y'all that talk about Walter Plecker was really reading past the first page, you'd have seen some of my history. Peace.
So when these brothers be talking about I'm copying off of them and I'm this and I'm that, you're going to see that all their talking points come back to things that I've said in the past. You're going to hear Aboriginal Power now talking about Lenape. You're going to hear the Tauntaun man. You're going to hear him talking about Lenape. You're going to hear motherfuckers talking about Walter Plecker. They're going to be going straight. And I laid all these things out for people back in, what, 2014, 15? Mentioned these names to people. And now these same individuals is talking crazy, trying to discredit what we've been doing. But they're using all our talking points, even talking points that don't apply to them. Everybody can't talk that Walter Plecker shit. When I was having this conversation with Jabari in 2018, I was going to explain this to him, right? I brought up Walter Plecker, and they just went straight to the, oh, everybody this, everybody that. No, everybody ain't connected to the information. And before I was able to show them my connection between myself and Walter Plecker, it spun into the craziness that the House of Consciousness spins into, and then everybody started going crazy. That's why I would never go on there and have no open line shit. Well, I can't lay this shit down. We're not going to have all that confusion and craziness and people calling in acting crazy. Not doing that shit. Fuck that. That's why I said, you know what? We don't need that shit. We'll do the shit on our own page. But all these talking points, all these arguments these people are making, all you got to do is do the research. all they shit is like, all they talking points come out of the video I did with Rich. All the shit they talk about. And it's their confusion about it. They claiming to be the original indigenous people. You just saw Professor Kaba talking about the different migrations which would have brought these people here. So if these people are really claiming to be somebody, they be tapping into that type of history because that's a documented history. But no, they're saying they're the original people who come from the dirt from here. So, like, they wrong on multiple levels. But now they're going to try and use Walter Plecker to explain who they are? Nah, it's a lot more details to it than that, bro. Sorry, can't do it. So let me get back to center screen so I can go back to doing my work.
A cousin of Charles Darwin. This mofo, listen, man, how y'all didn't catch this shit is beyond me. But this dude cannot read.
Pseudoscientific claims of eugenics. The word coined in 1883 by Francis Galton, your boy, right? And who else? Charles Darwin, your other boy, right? What would he be doing hanging out with these individuals, right? What you think this guy right here, you think like these individuals right here are all part of the secret societies and all this other shit?
Three minutes, man.
God damn. All right, let me get with it. All right, so Charles Darwin, it said, mean well born.
And this nigga gonna keep reading this bullshit. This has nothing to do with the debate topic. Nothing to do with the debate topic. And he just lied on Charles Darwin, right? He just lied on Charles Darwin. He made the whole shit up. Sutek trying to give him a pass and say he meant to do that. But you, Sutek, and I know that that's a part of his reading comprehension. You saying he did the shit on purpose? No, motherfucker, he ain't do that shit on purpose. He really thought cousin meant Charles. He really thought that it insinuated that Charles and Galton created this shit. He said it. He just said, why would Plecker be hanging out with Galton and Charles Darwin? When the paragraph, it ain't nothing but two sentences. We two sentences, y'all. Two sentences into this fucking article. And this nigga making errors. Mm. Excuse me. I'm trying to listen. Listen, kids, if y'all are listening to this, this is what stupidity does to me. Right? It bothers me to the 10th degree. And my passion comes out. I be wanting to control it at times, but sometimes I just can't when it's this stupid. This is a level of stupidity that is unbeknownst to me. And this is consistent with everything that goes on over there. Very consistent. It doesn't say that Charles Darwin hung out with Galton or Plecker or ever insinuates that Plecker hung out with Galton. All it says is that Plecker was an advocate of pseudoscientific claims of eugenics, which was a word that was coined by Francis Galton in 1883. Who is Francis Galton? Well, he's the cousin of Charles Darwin. That's it. So just to make it clear, there's no insinuation. Oh, Charles Darwin cousin, Galton. Yeah, the dude who came up with the whole eugenics name. Yeah, Plecker took that shit and ran with it in 1920. That was some pseudo shit. Oh, okay, cool. That's what's going on. So, here we go. Remember, the research question is, was black people here in America before 1492? Does he answer it?
Eugenicists argued that racial and genetic purity resulted in a more stable society. All right, so now we know exactly what these individuals were working with, right? When they was classifying so-called Indians as colored and saying that they was mixed blood. Now understand this, right? There's also some trickery to this, right? The point of what they claim he was trying to do, they were saying that he was pretty much like trying to keep the European blood pure. And anybody who had Negro blood in them, they would classify them as white. I mean, they was classifying them as Negro. The same thing, vice versa. So when they say the mix, they had Negro blood, they meaning that the Indians were actually Negroes and the Europeans, some of the Europeans mixed, or we mixed with them.
That shit don't say that nowhere in this article. Everything that he just said, it does not. What it does say, right here, it says, asserting that Virginian Indians were, in fact, mixed-blooded Negroes. That's it. The Virginian Indians were mixed-blooded Negroes. So there was an Indian population, and then there was a Negro population, and that they mixed. So we need to reclassify the mixed-blooded Indians as just as colored, or Indians as colored. So he
there that's you it. Go.
This gives you the whole argument on how Indians got labeled colored.
There you go.
Because they could not be white.
Not just every
and they were not Negro.
Classified Indians, primarily mixed Indians.
This simple, dumb stuff, man.
Negroes were already classified.
Does he answer the question? Let's just go ahead.
So, you know, that's been a point of contention this whole time with these classifications. And these classifications are done on purpose.
Indians,
so with that, they didn't get into what I need to get in. That was actually just I was just reading that just to connect the dots with everything from these different classifications and these different terminology. But now we can get into it, okay? All right. Once again, I say that with emphasis, right? America was a Negro continent, right?
No, it wasn't.
So, you know, just to start it off, you know, we got the term nigger right here, right?
A minute and a half.
Yo, I'm gonna need like 10 more minutes, man.
For what?
I mean, not a coincidence to present whatever he wanna present. You can pull your whole library out if you want. But let me just continue this right here. Let me just get like, you said how many minutes I got, AP?
A minute and 14 seconds, or 10 seconds.
All right. So the term nigger or Negro in the so-called Oxford Dictionary.
Listen, I think these rounds was 10 minutes or whatever the case may be, 8 minute rounds. We are 7 minutes into this fucking shit. And looks what he does at the end of the 7 minutes. He has 1 minute left and he begins to try to define Negro. Not the word black, Negro. Y'all, he ain't even trying to define black. He trying to define the fucking word Negro, nigger.
I don't even understand what defining black would do.
What are we doing?
People that were here when they...
What are we doing?
Were not Negroes. They were not black. They were not niggers.
7 minutes into the fucking debate, and he never defines black, but he chooses to define nigger. Mother, how the fuck did he beat you? Oh, because you was on there playing turf.
At this,
so just to start it off, you know
you
got the term nigger right here, right?
A minute and a half.
You got to call him Negro.
Mind you, the motherfucker ran the clock back, and I ain't going to say anything.
Tribal name.
Yo, I'm going to need like 10 more minutes, man. I mean, not you a motherfucker is Negro. Whatever he want to present. You can pull your whole library out if you want. But let me just continue this right here. Let me just get like, you said how many minutes I got, AP?
A minute and 14 seconds, or 10 seconds.
All right. So the term nigger or Negro in the so-called Oxford Dictionary.
It's a
dark-skinned person of any origins. In early U.S.
little table.
In early U.S. usually with reference to American Indians.
Table that you put the kids at. The little
now, do they call American Indians niggas today?
7, 8, 9 years
old. With the classifications that we got, that boy right there, Walker Blanco, was part of the Eugenics Society, right? We can understand these.
We had the classifications before Walter Plecker. Ladies and gentlemen, we had the. Okay, let me tell you how why we had these classifications, right? Right.
Yeah, tell them.
The fucking word Negro in Spanish,
yes,
and Latin denotes what? Black.
That's it.
When the Portuguese come into West Africa, what the fuck you think they were using? The word black to denote. What do you think they were using? The Arab was using to denote. They were using different culture, not dealing with skin tone, but dealing with culture. The Badani meant white, more like them. The Sudani meant black. They were denoting, right? They were making distinguishing. Clear separation. They were distinguishing for without a shadow of a doubt that these motherfuckers below the Sudan, them was where the niggas is at.
Descriptive terms.
But he still does not define the word black.
Different classifications, right? So, just for the individuals that's just coming to the table and just trying to understand some of this, right? These is like, you know, just earlier, you know, lessons pertaining to these this typical topic of us being an American, who the Americans are, right? So once again, America, a native of America, originally applied to the Aborigines or copper colored races, right?
Did he show that shit? Did he? He didn't define nothing. The debate is not about American. The debate about was black people in America before 1492. Even in what he's showing right now, American, a noun, native of America, originally applied to aboriginals or copper color races found here by the Europeans, but now applied to the descendant of the Europeans born in America. That last part is some bullshit. The first part of that is the fact part. It's a noun, a native of America, originally applied to the aboriginals or copper color races found here by the Europeans. He never that, but this ain't even got nothing to do with the argument because this doesn't say black people in America before 1492. So he never establishes a definition of who is these black people. He gave you American and he gave you nigger. He ain't give you no black. And his time is up. But watch what happened.
So, you go here. Go back three to the seconds, census
three,
right here.
3 seconds. 3 seconds.
3 seconds. Come on, bro.
Time.
How many rounds do we got, bro? I can't work like this. I need more time than this.
This nigga making an excuse.
Well, y'all agree to these times. Listen, I'm willing to give y'all a 3 minute. I'm willing to give you another 2 minute additional time, and I do the same thing for not a coincidence. I'm gonna bring both of y'all on.
Give him 2 minutes. He sound like he's struggling. Give him 2 minutes.
Shit, I'm just getting started, nigga. Shit.
All right, so we're gonna give you another two minutes.
I wouldn't have gave him shit. I wouldn't have gave him nothing. Why I'm gonna give him something? Oh, listen. See, this is how I know Anada C was smoking and laughing while listening to this dude first round, because he was generous. You know, hey, give him 2 more minutes, man. He seemed like he's struggling anyway. So give him 2 more minutes. What he present ain't gonna help him any damn way. Just give him 2 more minutes. Come on, man. Don't get this mofo nothing, not a C.
but you have a 30-second grace, okay? That's for both of y'all rounds, okay? Not coincident. DJ Cuddy, you got that? We're going to give another two with a 30-second grace.
All right, to go back into, all right, so we got the 1860 census, the instructions to the U.S. Marshals. We'll go right here. We're going to go to schedule number one, free inhabitants. Then we go down here to Indians. Once again, say Indians not taxed are not to be enumerated. The family of Indians who have renounced their tribal rule and are under state or territory laws exercise rights of citizens. So they would classify these citizens as what? And they are to be enumerated. In all such cases, I write IND opposite their name in columns 6 under the heading color. So once again, we're getting more reference that they put in these classifications on our people, right? So when we deal with the word copper color, we're dealing with numerous different brown shades. We're dealing with burnished, chestnut, copper, rustic, rust, tan, burnished, metallic brown, reddish tan, right? These are some of the images of the shades that our people come in, right? So these are all what we would call copper color, right? So going beyond that.
How do you establish that there was Negroes in America before 1492? If not a coincidence, just gave you two more minutes to define who the black people are and then to demonstrate who the black people are. And you're showing us some fucking old ass pennies.
Right, knowing now that they classify Indians as color, right, we revisit the NAACP, and in visiting the NAACP,
oh holy shit! So let's establish this. When was the NAACP formulated? When was it formed? February 12th, 1909 is the birth of the NAACP. How the fuck does that help you answer? Was black people in America before 1492?
Observing the colored people, because all of these people are referenced as colored, right? All of these people would have been referenced as color, right? Obviously, among the crowds, you see some Europeans in the front right here, but the majority of colored people, what we term Negroes.
Yeah, here we go.
Right? These are the majority of the
colored Northeast.
People. Right? Here go some more images of what we call the NAACP, right? Some more images of people who are classified as colored, right? Now, I don't know what an Indian look like. I mean, I don't know what people think an Indian look like, right? But these are all Indians right here. These are people who renounced their tribal rule and now are taking the term, taking the direction under the governor or the government and being governed. And they're reclassified from actually their nation that they originally was in, right? So we got more individuals from the NAACP, right? So, you know, when you look through these images, right, we like, you know, wow. Talk. Oh, shit. All right.
What a 45-second grace period.
Boy, I got 45 more seconds.
Trying to give him...
No, you had an extra 45 besides.
He's still 40, giving 40. Him time.
Damn,
all right,
man.
The time been up.
Shout out to everybody that's in the building, man.
Fuck out of here. I'm not about to play Not a Coincidences round. Because y'all can go on Not a Coincidences channel and support his channel, right? And watch this shit for yourselves. The rest of it by yourself. What I merely wanted to do was show an example of why these dudes are stupid. and why I don't care if they ever want to have a conversation with me.
Goofy.
And why, let me put my face on the screen. I want my $100 from old boy. Hide behind that username, which I know is you, Zab. I know that's you. I know you that dude. I want my $100. You made a bet, you lost a bet, pay up. Stop playing with me. You can send it to not a coincidence. Not a see, he send you the 100. He send you the 100, send me 50. Straight up. I told you not a see. You see, now that you can really watch the replay for yourself and analyze what the fuck was going on, you can see what was going on. The dude got 8 minutes to present, then another 2 minutes and 45 seconds with a 30-second grace period. So another 3 minutes and 15 seconds. So all in all, he had almost 15 minutes to present against you, bro. 15 minutes. The debate is 25 minutes in. All right. Hold up. Let me put it on the screen. Let me show you. Let's do the math. Right. 25 for emotional trauma. Right. So look. He's stopping now, not a C. It's 25-26 into the bill.
I'm good. A1, mic check. Let's get it, man. What you doing?
Peace to the guys, man. Let me know how my mic sound.
Heads or tails, nigga.
So at the third, told you. Damn near 15 minutes, man. Really was 12. Like 12 or some change. But damn near 15 minutes, bro. First round. Fucking pathetic, man. Pathetic. You gave him 2 minutes. The round was 8 minutes. Some kind of way he ends up presenting for almost 13 minutes. That's the hoodooism. Hey, who doing us, man? But he never answered the research question, and he damn sure didn't do it in the second round. He arguing some whole other shit. He was so worried about eugenics and shit, it just goes to show you, like, they don't know how to fucking argue. Look, I was in the back with my feet up. Told you, he was just, wasn't even caring what he was presenting. Go ahead, my nigga. You got 2 more minutes. Let me get this little nap in real quick before I gotta say something. You know what I'm saying? That's not a seat. Not a seat was like this. Hands behind his head and shit. Maybe the game was on. Was you debating this fool with the NBA playoffs was on or some shit? That was more interesting. You was over there like that. Ah, dang, he missed that shot. Dang, they just stole him. Dang, they up 12. Is it time for me to present yet? Oh, no, nah, he's still talking. Yeah. Dang. Damn. Hurry up, man. He almost done. Oh, you got to call a timeout. He over there talking to the TV. Not a coincidence, was not listening to the debate, y'all. He was watching the basketball game. The entire time that the Autonomous One, A1, was presenting information, Nodacy is on record for watching a basketball game. And it was the fourth quarter, and it was getting good. So he's like, yeah, give him 2 more minutes. The audacity of this dude. You should be ashamed of yourself for allowing that type of bull trap junk to transpire. but they don't know how to research, and they don't know how to qualify or organize their facts to present them. This is why they gish gallop and they talk in circles. They don't know how to present a plausible argument. They have no history. They have no existence. They have no data that would substantiate their existence here in the New World before 1492, which was the debate topic, and much more. Now, I know I just seen about 9 people just fall off. They mad. I know who those 9 people was. Them was the abos that was listening. Yeah, see, when you slow this shit down and point out they flaws, the niggas get up and they get out of the chat. They wasn't in the chat in the first place, but they were tuned in. They want to talk about my mustache, talk about Hitler. They want to say all of that stuff about me. And I don't care. You say what you want to say about me, how I look. I bet y'all look damn good to your old lady. I bet you that. Tysam, you try to call me CIA because you pseudo as fuck. I bet your old lady wouldn't mind having this CIA agent. She like a man with a badge anyway. She gonna be disappointed because I ain't got no badge. So y'all can talk about how I look, I don't care. All they got is that, Callie. Claims. No evidence. Show me, bring me one person out of that, whether they claim to be an Indian or they claim to be Aboriginal. Bring me one person that has ever shown you evidence. There's one dude that has shown up on, one dude that has shown up on Garfield's platform that I will honor some respect for and entertain. Because he even took a damn DNA test and he knows that he has native ancestry, but he's did all this other work. The only problem that I actually have with him is the fact that he thinks he's a fucking Moor. But he argues against the Abos because they don't have the shit that he got, and he knows that. Now I know NAC, you not a coincidence, you're gonna say Turtle Gang is similar to their Moor dude, right? They similar. And they might be, but that dude showed and proved his DNA. Turtle Gang ain't doing that shit. Turtle Gang got excuses.
Turtle Gang don't have to show and prove DNA because Turtle Gang never denied his African ancestry.
Facts, Thomas.
What is the problem?
They old ladies do be checking in and watching.
That's crazy.
Let them be mad watching this shit, and they old ladies in the background trying to see what he hollering at. Talking about my mustache and shit. Maybe I need to go over there on y'all channel more. Convert some of them women.
So,
let me tell you why he upset. He upset because when he tried to get at me when I was on Nada Quince's page, he couldn't budge me. And when I didn't deny that I had African ancestry, there was really no argument he could have with me. And then on top of that, he started talking this shit. When I told him about what we were doing, Fauna was doing with African nations and the partnerships. And then I invited him the next day to join me at an event we were going to with hosted by African nations. And then I told him for him, I would go live from that place, of which I did. So he wants to be stuck on me showing him. And I told him, who are you for me to show you anything? What resources do you have for me that I need the motherfucking be trying to bend over backwards to get your fucking approval? Like, who the fuck is you? That's how I spoke to him, and he ain't like that shit. But I mean that shit. Like, I like what you doing, exposing them, but don't get caught up in your feelings fucking with Turtle Gang, nigga. And he talking about he believe a Moor over Turtle Gang? That show you he don't know what the fuck he talking about. So, as I say with anybody, talk long enough, they'll expose themselves. So he believed a Moor because the Moor showed him his DNA. Did the Moor show him a connection to a tribal community? Did the Moors show him participating in any cultural activities? No, the nigga's telling you he's a Moor. So if the nigga's telling you he's a Moor, what is he telling you? He's telling you he's practicing his African traditions. So he's comfortable with that because the dude's practicing his African traditions, right? That's the real thing. Like, what do you mean? You think a Moor could show and prove? Wow. So now he's smart, but he got ego issues. So now I told him before when we was online, I respect you, but not really, because I can see you in your emotions. You know what I'm saying? And you know, and I say that because I never said nothing disparaging about him. You see, I'm sitting here watching his channel. I'm supporting his channel, right? I'm watching his channel. Never said nothing disparaging about him. But you see what happens with all these people. They bring my name up. So we can all bear witness that I'm sitting here watching his channel, supporting him, right? And what happens? All these weird niggas bring my name up. All these motherfuckers. I be minding my business. Don't be saying shit to none of these fucking weirdos. And that includes you too now, nigga. That's twice you done fucking tried to put some shit on my name like you're somebody important. The world don't give a fuck about you. Don't care about what you think. Pull up Saturday. Like, come on, bro. You doing what you doing with Africa. You writing books. Cool, great. I never said nothing disparaging about you. Stop trying to cast negativity upon me because you feel like I don't meet up to your standards, but you have no standards. You are in no position to demand any standards from anyone other than somebody coming on your little live show. You can't even control the fact that I can fucking replay your shit on my channel because it ain't even yours. It belongs to YouTube. The fuck is we talking about? This ain't even your intellectual property no more. Just like the shit ain't my intellectual property. But guess what? It never was my intellectual property. That's why the shit I say, you can look it up and find it and verify it, because it's not mine. It's the truth. That's the difference between me and all these other niggas. None of this shit I say is mine. It's the truth. It belongs to the world. So you can try and debunk me, which is the truth, not me personally. I align myself with the truth. That's how you stay righteous. Align yourself with the truth, speak the truth, walk in the truth, walk in the light. You know what I'm saying? That's why when it's time to pull the sword out, you can get as bloody as you want because you know you're doing it righteously. So that's why I don't got like nobody until my spirit tell me, okay, have some compassion for me. So when I hear a motherfucker talking slick about me and got my name in his mouth, I don't have to have compassion for you. And I can see it for what it is. You got your own little personal issues because you still got issues with a man who's sitting here supporting your fucking channel. That's your own personal issues. Fucking weird niggas, bro. Weird niggas. Don't get no weirder than this. Matter of fact, fuck this nigga. Yeah. Fuck that nigga. I'll never watch that nigga's channel again. How about that? I don't need your shit. That shit was entertainment, nigga. It's a million motherfuckers getting at these athletes. But everybody got a problem. I'm telling you, y'all gonna see. Everybody got a problem with Turtle Gang. Motherfuckers don't like whatever it is. It's the confidence. Like, get your weight up. Don't be put off by me, because I'm confident in the things I say and I walk in that light. Shit crazy. Niggas exposing yourselves. You so upset with these abos, you want to deny another man of his truth. That's devil. I don't like, this is what I mean. Like, niggas need a fucking math, yo. That's so devil, bro. You so upset with these niggas on your left that you can't take the time to do the knowledge to the people on the right. So you just gonna put them all together. So what you basically saying is all y'all colored. Ain't no So you're just going to denationalize. You're going to strip everybody of their identity and just throw us all into one thing because you got problems with these niggas over here. And it's really some shit you got with yourself that's probably an issue, which is why this whole Abbo thing irks you so much. I know why these niggas irk me so much. These niggas is calling my name just like you're fucking calling my name. But I don't know what be irking all you other niggas. Like, none of this shit is personal. When these niggas sit up here and say one of these teachers is pseudo, ain't none of you niggas related to these motherfuckers. Ain't none of you niggas got personal relationships with these people. None of y'all. When they attack your philosophies and your belief systems, these are all belief systems that you chose for yourself. Belief systems that come from all over the world. You up here defending Africa. Africa got motherfucking nations with motherfucking armies. You know what I'm saying? Navies. They got all types of shit to defend themselves. And you a nigga in America defending their interests. Talking shit. Like you gonna bring something to Africa. Like you gonna go over there and teach them something. Fuck out of here. Niggas be wildin'. So here it is, you think you special because you holding down a nation that is complete within itself, gonna do what it do with or without you. Feel me? Any African nation you speak for gonna do what it do with or without you. You're not even connected to it. You're just speaking about it. When we speak about our nations, we're literally connected to it. And for many of us, we're a part of the government and we're a part of what determines whether or not our nations are gonna thrive and survive. You niggas is on the sideline cheering on fucking Ghana, cheering on Senegal, cheering on all these nations. But that's all you're doing is cheering them on from the sideline. You're not doing nothing for your nation of people that you fucking eat with every day. But you wanna talk shit to people who are actually doing things for the people they eat with every day. Building a nation. And all that shit you're doing too, building with the people in your community that you live around, yeah, we're doing all that too, because everybody do that. If you're a good person, you're gonna do that. You're gonna build with not only your nation, but you're gonna build with the fucking communities you live in. So don't act like the everyday shit that niggas do, everybody else ain't doing. Like, don't act like because I'm building for my nation, I'm not involved in 24 hours of peace. Don't act like I'm not involved in other interests that aren't directly related to my nation because they're directly related to my community. Don't act like I'm not involved in hip hop based events. All this stuff is to bring awareness and to bring change and upliftment to communities. So we can't play the game like, oh, y'all just worried about yourself and y'all not worried about, no. We taking care of our nation at the same time we doing what we can for the communities we live in because we fucking live in the communities. So a nigga can't be living in Newark, nigga can't live in Brooklyn, be a Lenape and just deal with his Lenape issues but not deal with what's going on in the community I live in. I gotta do both. And then I gotta tie the two together so the two can begin to support each other. Like, but perfect example, his brother, you know what I mean? Watch, you gonna hear him, he gonna keep saying my name. There's no need for him to say my name. Not a reason. You could literally, he wants DNA when he could literally just look the people up. Let me show y'all something. Let me show y'all how easy this is. This shit easy. I'm gonna show y'all something. Let's go. How are we gonna do this? Let me pull this up. Let me show y'all how easy this is. All right. Let me see. All right. I'm gonna show y'all. All right, so look, this is how easy this is. This is how transparent we are. All right. So you see that, right? Simple Google. Sandhill Indians. S-A-N-D-H-I-L-L Indians. I ain't got to put no state. I ain't got to do nothing. Let's press enter. Bomb. Sandhill Indians, Native American genealogy, Lincroft. Look, pictures come up. Those are the Richardson men. That's Chief Crummel. John Richardson, Lone Bear Reavy. Like, these are my elders. Now look, Sandhill Indian Historical Association, New Jersey Sandhill Band of Lenape and Cherokee Indians. New Jersey-based Sandhill Lenape Indians, Seek Long. Look, you can go into news cases, Seek Long overdue federal, state, and recognition. Look, all types of stuff going on. You're seeing all, look, lawsuit against, look at this. With lawsuit against New Jersey, little-known Indian group is thrust into the spotlight. 2009, the story of the Sandhill Indians and the $1 trillion lawsuit begins on a wooded slope in Monmouth County. Like, what are we talking about? It's real easy. I'm not hard to find. This is my people. And the more you dig into it, you can see, okay, these are real people, right? And then you can just go on my page and I'll tell you everything, laid everything out. This is not something that is not, like, you don't gotta, they ain't burn these records. These records ain't burnt. You know why these records ain't burnt? Because we still active and we never stop. That's why you can see current cases of us suing the state. And guess what? We're not suing the state because we really think we're going to win. We're suing the state because that's how you start fucking letting these niggas know you serious. Start going on record. Don't expect to win that. Should act up a little bit. But see, it's that easy. It's that easy, yo. He could start right there. He could start right there. And then, if he wanted to be slick, he could be like, all right, who are these people? And start asking for the names of the people. Could do all that little fuck shit that niggas do when they act like they know something. Pull up some information, study it for a little while, write some notes, some bullet points. Then they go in front of other people and act like they know this information. And they're reading off of bullet points. You could bump into me on the subway anywhere and start asking me questions about the culture and the heritage and the history, and I'm going to go in. I don't need nothing. And everything I'm going to say, you could verify. You could Google it in the moment. These people can't speak on their history like that. They can speak on general world history. They don't know themselves. They don't have knowledge of self. So they want to have these deep intellectual conversations. And when they get around people that can really facilitate that level of conversation, they get uncomfortable because all they want to talk about is slavery, right? Documents. They want to talk about what was recorded in the history, right? They want to talk about shit that, listen, bro, I could go get a fucking library card. Like, see, I don't know, y'all, I'm old. I'm an old dude. We grew up going to the library, having to have a library card. Certain things you wanted to read, you wanted to gain access to, you had to go to the library. That was like a part of our culture growing up. Niggas had library cards. If nothing else, we had a goddamn library card. Like, shit, I don't know what else to tell you, motherfuckers. We used to be up in the library. Our library was across the street from, like, where all the stores and shit is. We used to have our mothers drop us off at the library, tell them to come get us in 3 hours, and we'd run across the street and be stealing. That's how we used to get down. We used to be up in that motherfucking library. Telling our parents to drop us off at the library was a way of getting unsupervised access to a whole bunch of shit that wasn't close to our houses, to where we grew up. We can get into a whole different environment and get dropped off and be on our own. What? Yes. Can you drop us off at the library? Yeah. Oh, yeah, y'all want to go to the library? Yeah, we're going to the library. Uh-huh. We over in Marshalls. We over in Burlington. Movie theater there. What else? All types of shit. Pancake House, all that shit. Strip malls, all that shit. Yeah, all that shit. Dope shit. Pizza place. Everything. But anyway, yeah, we had library cards, bro. We had library cards. So all this information that y'all just now, nah, we was close to it. We had to make effort to get this information, right? So now you could just Google the shit. So I don't know why homeboy is struggling. Like, Turtle Gang really got a whole YouTube page, 1,000 videos, got multiple YouTube pages. All you gotta do is type Turtle Gang in, the shit pop up. What you struggling with? All right, enough of that. Hold up, let me see something. Some nigga said I ain't telling the truth. Fuck truth, am I leaving out? Practice what you preach in your mind. Oh, that's just a regular thing. I'm like, what the fuck is this? That's just like a marketing thing. So practice what I preach. I don't see none of these niggas practicing what they fucking preaching. Out. Yeah, man. Hold up. Because some nigga said something. See if this nigga's online. See if his ass wanna fucking come have the conversation. This nigga's been talking shit. We be talking shit, but we having my name in they fucking mouth. Yeah, I handle my business. Yo, so yeah, that nigga just interrupted my little, I was having fun listening to you break them niggas down. Now I can't listen to your dumb ass no more. Oh, well. All right, well, I'm gonna get out of here for a minute. Peace. Y'all continue to have a great day. I'll randomly pop back in. Peace.